Good to see everybody this morning. No groups tonight, or no kids group anyway. I don't know what all the groups are doing. We do have church this Wednesday night, starting at 6:30, so you can come and be a part of that if you can. In Psalms 103, 19 through 22, it says, "The Lord has established his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, O you his angels, you mighty ones who do his word, obeying the voice of his word. Bless the Lord, all his host, his ministers who do his will. Bless the Lord, all his works in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul." What does Scripture command us to do? Bless the Lord. Be a blessing to the Lord. And I know often I'm not that. I should be different, should try harder and be better. And I encourage you this morning to do the same. And there's no better way to start blessing the Lord by humbly standing together and singing worship and singing praise to him. So let's stand together. Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in when death was arrested and my life began. Ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given a name. My mourning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. My chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began, oh, your grace, so washes over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new. Savior displayed on a criminal's cross. Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Is over me. You have made me new. Now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us.
team. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, we're free, free, forever, we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free, forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began. Yeah. You are our life. When death is all around, you are our peace. When all else seems to fail, you are our strength. When our weakness overcomes, you are, yes, you are. When our world is shaken, when our hope is broken, still you are God of all. Falls around, your word speaks true. When we're lost and wandering, you are our God. Above you, there's no one else. You are, yes, you are. When our world is shaken, when our hope is broken, still you are God of all.
Commands all the host of heaven. Who else could make every king bow down? Who else can whisper and darkness tremble? Only a holy God. What other beauty demands such praises? What other splendor outshines the sun? What other majesty rules with justice? Only a holy God. Come and behold you, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the holy God. What other glory consumes like fire? What other power can raise the dead? What other name remains undefeated? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one and the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God. Come and worship the can rescue me from my failing. Who else would offer his only son? Who else invites me to call him father? Only a holy God. Only a holy God. Come behold.
Ministry to us from his word today. We're going to be looking at the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 11. I think we're going to read a verse that's very familiar to you in this passage, but we're going to read from verses 20 through verse 30 in Matthew chapter 11. And this is, again, I think a familiar verse. One of the verses will be very familiar to many of us because it contains this command. And that's what we're looking at in this series of messages are commands that Jesus has given to us, and specifically this command today is to come to me. Jesus says, come to me. He doesn't request that. He doesn't invite that. He commands it. It's come to me. And so we want to hear this word of Christ. We want to hear this instruction from Christ. I pray in a way that is going to be meaningful to our souls today. But first, let's stand together and read this text of Scripture. And then after we have read the Word of God, please remain standing as we pray and commit this hour to the Lord. Hear the word of the Lord. Then he began to denounce the cities where most of his mighty works had been done, because they did not repent. Woe to you, Chorazin! Woe to you, Bethsaida! For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I tell you, it will be more bearable on the day of judgment for Tyre and Sidon than for you. And you, Capernaum, will you be exalted to heaven? You will be brought down to Hades. For if the mighty works done in you had been done in Sodom, it would have remained until this day. But I tell you that it will be more tolerable on the day of judgment for the land of Sodom than for you. At that time, Jesus declared, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father. And no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. This is the word of the Lord. Let's pray. Father, for anyone to enter the courts of heaven, we must be recipients of and children of your grace. And today, your word presents to us a challenge in the reading that will be an attack on our proud hearts, and also, Lord, a revelation to us about coming judgment. But as we have heard the Lord Jesus issue a command with no direction except the heart of everyone who hears, I pray that this morning, that when that command is given, if there is someone here who does not know Christ, someone here who has never entered this rest, Lord, that they will know that it is Christ himself who pronounces this to us if we will just believe, repent, and receive his gospel. Lord, bless us today in the preaching of your word. I pray what I say is clear and shows a concise agreement with what you have spoken to us already in the scripture. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. You may be seated. At some point, I guess all of us have to be some kind of a fan of public speaking. I don't mean that you have to be a public speaking nerd. You know, you don't have to find your favorite speakers, but at some point we all have to be able to listen to and appreciate when somebody speaks to us about something. And whenever you listen to enough people, I think all of us knows that there is a line or a phrase or a hook that many times people will have. They will tend to say the same thing, even if it's only for a season. Maybe it will be a period of time where that statement comes up. In my earlier adult life, I remember when the Reverend Billy Graham had done a chapel service for then President Bill Clinton shortly after he was elected to his second term in office. And nobody knew what Dr. Graham had said to President Clinton had it not been for the fact that President Clinton began to repeat over and over what he had heard in that devotional or chapel service. And those of you that may remember that brief period of history, it lasted for about 2 months. Almost every speech was about being a repairer of the breach. President Clinton over and over would talk about this, being a repairer of the breach. And then it was Dr. Graham's devotional from the book of Isaiah that revealed that it was in fact instruction that was being given as a chaplain to one of the presidents. The next presidency was President Bush. I remember the Gaither Vocal Band came and did a Southern Gospel night, and they sang this song that you would really have to hear to see how inspirational it would be, and it was a song called Let Freedom Ring. And David Phelps has this monster solo, if you know anything about that group. And he has this monster solo where his high tenor voice comes in. And I mean, just you know, it goes all the way to your toes, this cry to let freedom ring. And President Bush came to his feet, and this was right after 9/11, when our nation was getting ready to be hurled into a couple of war fronts because of what had occurred. And you heard over and over in President Bush's dialogue, in his rhetoric that he was giving to the people, that deep within the heart of every man and woman in the world is a cry for freedom. Basically a direct quote from that song. It's not unusual for that to be something that happens whenever we are trying to preach in a way, or speak, excuse me, in a way that connects with the heart of people, to have something that is specific, that targets everyone, that everyone can be familiar with. Through the years, I've gotten to hear a lot of preaching, good preaching and bad preaching, sometimes my own. Whenever you listen to a lot of preaching, it's good to have a fresh perspective, to hear how somebody else is approaching, correctly understanding what the Bible is saying, and then they say it different than I would say it, maybe different than what you would be thinking about it, but the thought itself becomes the same. But whenever you listen to preaching, good preaching, even not so good preaching, and quite frankly, bad preaching that is trying to do the job right, at least is going to say something that the soul needs to hear. I remember an old pastor still among us up here in northeastern Arkansas, Brother Jerry Jolly. He was my pastor years ago, whenever I was a boy. Brother Jerry one time said, regarding a young man that was getting ready to preach to a group of preachers, he said, "You'd better listen to this guy, because you never know when a man is going to deliver the greatest sermon you've ever heard." All preaching at some point, you see, is going to say what our soul needs to hear, repeat something that must be brought to our attention. I've been here for a year and a half now, and you probably notice not only me but other preachers that you would listen to, that there are some verses that do come immediately to mind in preaching because of their appeal. They're not crutches, they're simply clear, they're concise things that need to be said often so that we never forget them. And so we do tend to repeat those things. We all know what John 3:16 says. And if I refer to John 3:16 and quote John 3:16, most of us begin mouthing the words along with each other in whatever version of the Bible that we had memorized those words. Because it is so important that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. We have the beautiful statement of the gospel. Whenever we are trying to make sure that everyone understands that the appeal for the gospel, for you to be saved so that you can know peace with God, is Romans 10 and 13. Whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. You see, these are verses whose appeal is necessary. In Revelation chapter 3, Jesus says to the church at Laodicea, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears me will answer, well, let me come in. I will come in and I will sit and I will eat with him." Christ speaking openly to us that all it is a matter of us not responding to him. Those are so easy. In fact, even what we have just read, it's not an unusual thing in an appeal or some note of clarity on the gospel for it to be said by me or another preacher, as Christ would say to us, "Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." These appeals are plain appeals. They're clear things that are said. But honestly, we sometimes, most of the time, when that appeal comes, I'm not giving it everything that is said in its immediate context. As we have just read, the entirety of this text sees that Jesus was saying this targeting a specific people and their heart condition, and that comes to us off of the page of Scripture as we have just read it, and it's going to speak to us about the condition of our hearts as well. Christ's command to come to him is a powerful one. Do you know how powerful this command is? In the Gospel of John, Jesus says, "Lazarus, come forth." And a dead man walked out of his tomb. That's how powerful it is. You see, it's so powerful that this is a response to this command of Christ that would be our heart response of a sinner turning from their sin and turning from death, and instead coming to know the righteousness of Christ and eternal life. It's a powerful word that we have from Jesus Christ. And as this is given to us in the Bible, it is a passage that is exposing our own sinfulness and our inability to save ourselves, to will ourselves into any kind of saving act or to come to Christ on our own. Today, we're going to observe that Christ's command to come to him reveals deep things about God and about our faith. I want to say it in this brief statement that of all his commands, none more powerfully shows us how we depend on God alone for salvation than hearing Jesus say, "Come to me." Of all of his commands, none reveal to us, especially as we consider it in the context of what is said, how we depend on God alone for salvation. Let's look at this from a few points this morning. The first one is that we do not come to Jesus unless Jesus is our treasure. We do not come to Jesus unless Jesus is our treasure. When you look at those first verses we read, beginning in verse 20, where Christ is announcing these woes of judgment on the unrepentant cities of Chorazin, Bethsaida, and Capernaum, Jesus does not speak in a kind way, and Jesus does not mince words concerning human depravity, concerning our sinfulness. The word that is given here is he began to denounce the cities. Denounce. This is a strong word because it is a stern, it is a vile word that is being said here. You see, this word, it's translated upbraid, if you use the King James, rebuke, reproach, and it's closely related. In fact, it can be equally translated insult and revile, because that's how it's used elsewhere in the Bible when this word is used applied to other people. An example is when Jesus in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 11 is talking about how those who are blessed, who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, they will revile you. Revile you. This is the word that's being used. Matthew 27 and verse 44, where Jesus is hanging between two thieves, and it says that the robbers reviled him. Same word. You see, it's talking about hurling an insult at that point. It's talking about speaking in a plain, unvarnished way so that it is abundantly clear where one is coming from. Jesus is not speaking softly here. He is speaking with a finger pointed toward the face of the cities. He's saying this is a vile condition. Someone who has finally been fed up and now it's up to our eyeballs, and this simply must be poured out. Christ says something here that is an unrestrained moment of speaking what he knows about the human condition, about our vile sinfulness. He also, in the midst of what we have read there, he announces a woe to Chorazin and a woe to Bethsaida. This word woe is also a powerful word. It's kind of an onomatopoeic word. It announces this heart-wrenching, gut-wrenching cry of sorrow. That this is a very emotive word that is being said. Woe to you. In the book of Revelation, this word is used. It's being used in the context of the sounding trumpets of judgment. Now, if you're familiar with the passage in Revelation chapter 8, the first four trumpets sound, and basically, a summary of what happens as the trumpets sound is a third part of everything is destroyed. A third part of people die. A third part of the lights in the sky disappear. A third part of the waters are turned into blood. It's devastating global calamity. A third of everything is wiped out. And then there is this refrain between the sounding of the fourth trumpet and the sounding of the fifth one, where an angel in heaven says, is crying, woe, woe, woe to those who dwell on the earth at the blasts of the other trumpets that the three angels are about to blow. If you think that judgment is terrible, this emotional cry is now being sounded from heaven. It is a pitiful thing. It is worse than pitiful what is about to be endured on the earth. If you think the first four were bad, wait until these next three trumpets sound. Christ uses that word regarding Chorazin and Bethsaida. It's a heartfelt cry. It's a gut-wrenching cry. It is a very emotional cry. He is saying, he is denouncing these cities where he had done most of his mighty work. But there's another sorrow, not just what is coming, but a sorrow expressed of what could have been. Because he says two times here, once of Tyre and Sidon both, and then once of Sidon by itself. If the mighty works had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented. And then he says to Capernaum, if what had been done in you had been done in Sidon, Sidon would still be standing to this day. Now we remember, I hope, the Old Testament story of Lot and God's rescue of him from Tyre and Sidon, these two wicked, perverse cities on which God pronounced his judgment and poured out fiery judgment, consuming the cities of that plain in a single evening. And they were gone. The only survivors were Lot and his daughters. And as they exited the city, God's full judgment was poured out on them. And so Christ pulls the most extreme example out of Old Testament history of God's fiery judgment and pronounces that on the cities of Chorazin, Bethsaida, and Capernaum, saying, woe to you, because these cities that had this judgment on them would have repented had they had done among you what has been done in your midst. You see, Christ is announcing here how desperately wicked our sinful condition is. How do we show by the greatest example, what is the greatest example of our wicked, sinful condition? If you don't treasure Christ today above all, our Lord, our Creator, our Redeemer, the one who bore the cross for us, bled and died for us. If you don't treasure Christ, friend, that is a wicked place for us to dwell in. Nothing proves our depraved nature more than our inability to treasure Jesus Christ. We might consider what heinous sins are. Because after all, those are the preaching points. One criticism that I get from kind of the desire for old-timey hellfire and brimstone preaching, one of the criticisms that often comes is that today, preachers don't preach enough about specific sins. You know, that was a pretty easy way out a generation ago. Let's preach about drunkenness and cussing and immorality, and let's talk about fornication. You know, you just go ahead and you can pick and choose, and what I'll do is I'll pick and choose the ones that we can point outside the door that's what's going on, but we never want to point at the hypocrisy. We never want to point at the unbelief. We never want to point at the sinfulness that remains in us. And Christ actually speaks in a merciful way, and even in a pathetic kind of way, regarding Sodom and Gomorrah, Tyre and Sidon, these cities that endured great judgment. Nothing proves our depraved nature more than the inability to treasure Christ. We might consider those wicked sins. These do indeed indicate a life that's not directed by the Holy Spirit. Galatians 5, 19 through 21 says, the works of the flesh are evident. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. It's an interesting thing when we look at these cities. Capernaum was a commercial center for the region. That's where all the trade took place, folks going in and out. Bethsaida was a fishing village close to Capernaum. It's where Peter and Andrew and Philip were from. Chorazin was the local breadbasket. It was the area known for its production of wheat. So all of those two cities, or those two villages, were villages that did most of their commerce in and out of the city of Capernaum. And it is said to us in these verses that Jesus had done most of his mighty works in these places. Most of his mighty works. That means to the exclusion of other towns he could have gone into, to the exclusion of other cities or regions that Jesus could have gone into, the scripture says Jesus did most. He healed the blind, the lame, the deaf, the leprous. Jesus cast out demons in these places, raised the dead. What is most? What is mighty? What would really make the deepest impact on every aspect of the society in that region? You know, it was in Bethsaida that Jesus eventually in the gospel will feed the 5,000. Did I forget to mention Bethsaida was a fishing village? That Chorazin was the wheat belt? And Jesus is going to take a little boy's lunch. Tyrell, you're getting ready, or maybe you've already done your fishing, you know, and you're getting ready to feed your family. At least I understand that's your tradition. And he's going to string out a trot line, and you're going to work pretty hard for several days to get all of that together if you're doing it. It's going to take a while. Jesus just prayed over a basket and fed everybody fish. He didn't retrieve them, skin them, fillet them, fry them. He just fed everyone. We've got farmers here. Michael and Brian, you're going to work all summer long. Hard work. You're going to sweat. You're going to stir up dirt. You're going to worry about drought. You're going to worry about pumping water and whatever other things come to mind whenever it comes to the efforts of farming. And not only that, but you have to have an extended group of people that serve, folks that repair equipment that breaks and everything like that. It takes immense effort so we can have bread on our table. And all Jesus does is praise over a basket, and he feeds the multitude in a moment. What mighty work could Christ have done that would have more impressed the masses than who have completely bypassed the entire system that is required to feed a multitude than to simply pray over a basket and feed everybody? Most of his mighty works, not just something where a healing miracle that maybe impacts one individual or a family and leaves several awestruck. No, we're talking about Christ was doing things that bore great impact on the entire society because the Son of God was dwelling among men doing incredible things. And the failure to treasure Christ or even to come to Christ aims at a far deadlier sin than I'm afraid we ever preach to directly. When Jesus was rejected at Nazareth, not far removed from this region, when they said, "Isn't this Mary and Joseph's child?" The scripture there says in Mark chapter 6, verse 5 and 6, he could do no mighty work there, except he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. Because of their unbelief. And he went about among the villages teaching. Jesus pronounces his woe to Chorazin, to Bethsaida. He announces his woe to Capernaum. He says, wicked places would have repented, and wicked places would have remained. Had they seen and heard what you have seen and heard, because they would have believed. But you have not believed. You see, no matter of doing, no matter of doing will ever convince anyone of anything apart from the work of God in somebody's heart. We have churches all over this nation today. If Bethsaida and Chorazin receive such a scathing denouncement from our Lord? What would the Bible Belt receive if Jesus preached a sermon to us today? How many people live in the Word and community? How many Baptist churches do we have in the Word and community? Not a town, not a city, not a county, a flat place between two towns. I count three Baptist churches where we don't even have a town. What would Jesus say to us about the work that is going on right here if we do not, and if there are folks who do not believe? You see, there yet remains something that must happen, and we all know it. And we need to listen to what Christ says here about it, because it gets down at the very crust of exactly what's wrong in our nation and our world, and why we yet have yet to see revival. We cannot come to Jesus unless God works powerfully in us. Look what he says. At that time, Jesus declared. At that time, Jesus declared. We need to gain a serious understanding of this mighty work of Christ. Christ had done many things, but there was one thing yet remaining. The word there is declared. This sounds, as we read it, like a prayer. It sounds like Jesus, and reads like, and is, in fact, Jesus speaking audibly and loudly to God the Father. Christ has done this, in our readings of the gospel. It's not the only time that he does it, but I want us to notice here that as he is in front of these crowds, speaking to these cities, denouncing their sin, this unbelief and rejection, thus they're not coming to him, how he speaks to the Lord first. I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth. He speaks to God in a royal way. He speaks to God in that way that we must address God as he has revealed himself to us. God, our creator, the Lord and sustainer of all things, without whom we do not exist and would not exist. He speaks to God in a sovereign way. He says that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. He speaks to us in what I believe is a mysterious way regarding how God moves in our salvation. If we try and figure this one out, we wind up falling off into a ditch on one side or the other regarding either God's sovereignty or man's free will. But here, Christ accosts us with this statement that it is something that God must do in the human heart in order for that heart to cry out, and that there is something that has been hidden from folks who you think should have that religious knowledge, and yet ignorant folks like us have believed the gospel. Such is your gracious will. Hey, folks, why aren't all the Baptist churches up in the Northeast where the most people live by population density? Why is it down here in farm country that we have all of these Baptist churches and the many stripes of churches that are around us? Why is that? Did you ever think it may have just been the gracious will of God that you would be saved? Christ doesn't even seek to give explanation for that. He makes it by statement that it's a royal way of speaking to God and a sovereign way of speaking to God. But also he speaks to God in a powerful way as he speaks according to God's gracious will. What is according to God's gracious will? He says in verse 27, "All things have been handed over to me by my Father. No one knows the Father except the Son and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him." He speaks of a mighty work. A mighty work that is done in the preaching of the gospel. If we, again, venture in great detail in these, I'm concerned that we'll become distracted by exactly what the Lord says, and that is how God is about saving our souls. Mighty work. The mighty work is a word that means incredible power. It is about a power that is an unstoppable force of power. The Greek word that is used here is a word dunamis, which is a root word to our English word dynamite. Whenever this word is used regarding Christ's mighty works here, it also is used in the same way regarding the gospel itself. When Paul was summarizing the gospel before he would expound on it in the book of Romans, he says, "I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God to salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greeks." The word power is the same word that we have that's the root of this word, the mighty works of Christ. So we can derive that the most powerful work that God works in us is the work of making a spiritually blind person see, a spiritually deaf person hear, and a spiritually dead person to live. The work of the gospel is the most powerful work of them all. Feeding the 5,000, nothing. Speaking the universe into existence, nothing. Saving a sinner by the grace of God, there's your miracle, friend. When he takes this dead heart and makes it alive, these blind eyes and causes us to see, there is the powerful work of God that God can work in you today. No matter the nature of other miracles, the greatest work of God is salvation. Good leaders walk in front of their army and they lead them into battle and men die. Great leaders inspire a population so they don't have to go into battle. They stay on the back lines, the army goes forward and they die. But a savior is neither. He does what no leader can. He can save everyone who comes to him. You see, this is the work that Christ is calling to our attention, the saving work of God. Do you know the mighty power of God in your life, sinner? Has there been a day where you have called on the name of the Lord and you have confessed Christ as your Savior? Where God has opened your eyes and you see, the preacher has said that Jesus is the Son of God. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God. The preacher has said that Christ died on the cross and bled for our sins. I believe that Jesus died on the cross. He bled for my sin. You believe and have heard that Christ rose again on the third day. I believe that Christ has rose. All of these things suddenly come into the mix and one cries out, "Lord, save me from my sin." This is a powerful, mighty thing that God does. And that's why it's so clear as we come to the conclusion of this, where so often we pull it out of the context of what Christ has said and we say instead, openly, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden." When we come to Jesus, we will find rest. When we come to him, we will find rest. Christ's call to come to him is an unhindered call. But there is a limit. There is. When we speak of God's gracious will, people will start talking. We can start talking about how God graciously works among people, and big theological words can come into play. But if we simply notice what Jesus says, if we simply get down to what Christ says, come to me. The very preaching of Jesus shows us two things. Jesus does not tell us or tell anyone they cannot come, excuse me. Jesus does not tell anyone they cannot come. Come to me. Everyone can come. Whosoever will may come. But Jesus does only call those who will come. He says, come to me. Have you come to the Lord? Have you heard what Christ has said? Have you seen what Christ has done? Have you read what God has done for us in Christ? Those who labor and are heavy laden, the spiritually fatigued, are called to come to Christ. Who does Jesus first pronounce his blessedness or happiness to in the Beatitudes? In Matthew chapter 5, those first four verses of that sermon are, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. The spiritually impoverished, the spiritually mourning, the meek, the hungering, the thirsting, those are the ones who are called blessed. And it is here that Christ says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden. Christ's call to come to him is an effective call to soothe what no one and nothing else can. For all the effort, from all the effort, and above all the effort, humanity finds there is no escape. It is an endless cycle of trying and failing. But if we come to Christ, today we can find rest for our souls. When Christ gave John the revelation of himself for persecuted Christians, as we come to the very close of the book of Revelation, notice another time that Christ powerfully says, come. The Spirit and the bride say, come. Let the one who hears say, come. Let the one who is thirsty come. Let the one who desires take the water of life without price. There are no limits to the call of Christ here. Do you hear him? Do you thirst for him? Do you desire him? Can you treasure him? Then come to him.